Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this critical conversation on the future of science on decision-making, multiple scientific perspectives. So I'd like to extend a greetings to our audience in person and those in our virtual audience. And I am Adrienne Stith Butler. I'm the Deputy Chief Science Officer at the APA. And I look forward to a lively discussion today and invite the audience, both in person and virtual, to join us by submitting questions to the panel at any point. So sign in to slido.com with the event code 899-1904. You can submit a question or like a question that's already been submitted, and they'll be crowdsourced. So questions with more likes will rise to the top. And my colleague, Dr. Derek Snyder from APA Science Directorate, Derek, will be moderating Slido for us, and he'll let us know in a bit, later in the hour about what we have. So remember that questions with the most votes will be the ones that Derek will ask. So great. So let's get started. We have an esteemed panel today of scientists, so let us meet. I'm going to do this in alphabetical order. Paul Glimcher, professor of psychology, neuroscience, economics, psychiatry from New York University. Dr. Hannah Perfecto, assistant professor of marketing at Washington University, St. Louis. Dr. Valerie Reyna, professor of psychology at Cornell University. And Dr. Lace Padilla, assistant professor of cognitive and information sciences at the University of California-Merced. So we will hear more about your expertise and your work as we have the discussion today. So I'd like for you to think of this as a discussion, like we're sitting in a living room, a big living room. So everyone should talk, no particular order, and feel free to ask one another questions, refer back to things that you've said before, things that you're curious about. Okay, great. So to start this, I'll say that in learning about each of you and your work, I was struck by the theme that the decisions people make about a variety of things are not good. So I want to start by having you each weigh in on that question. Why do people make decisions that are suboptimal? What's going on? Who would like to start? Oh, he's pointing to you.
Valerie. Okay.
They're already pointing. Yeah. Well, I think the classical economic answer is, of course, people just are not, you know, estimating probabilities correctly. They're not sensitive enough to the magnitude of their outcomes, like losses. There are terrific losses involved in making some wrong decisions, like, for example, vaccination and things like that. Losses like death. So that's the classical answer. I think the psychological answer. So if you weighed the, you know, the probabilities and the outcomes, you multiplied them appropriately. If you were, you know, it's a math problem, would sort of be the economics answer. The psychology answer is more, there are tragic outcomes. So probability times outcome isn't enough. It's about the tragedy of the outcomes, and you want to avoid those tragedies. And I would say my perspective is really a third way to think about it. And that is, regardless of the verbatim details, which may be very risk-promoting, you know, a small probability of a very bad outcome, maybe the math says you should go for it. But what I would argue is that when people make the wrong decision, often it's because they fail to get the gist of the decision, the bottom line qualitative meaning of the options, and they're lost in those verbatim details.
Thank you, Valerie.
All right, I'll try.
Okay, go ahead, Paul.
I mean, as you guys all know, what I'm really interested in is why people make such bad decisions, not just what bad decisions they make. And because I'm, in addition to being a psychologist, I'm a neuroscientist, I'm really interested in the biology of that. One of the things that really stands out to me when we try and understand the biology of decision making is just what cheap computers we are. And by that, I don't mean that we're inexpensive. I mean that we just don't use a lot of power. You know, the computer on my desk uses 500 watts of power, and my brain uses about 10 watts of power. And so much of our biological computation is built around doing a lot with a little. And the tricks that we use to achieve energetically efficient computation, focusing ourselves on little details, focusing ourselves on what we expect, paying less attention to unexpected or low probability events, those are really efficient tools for an inexpensive computer to adopt. But they lead us astray in exactly the way that Valerie described, missing the risks of very low probability events that we just don't focus on because it's not good practice for an inexpensive computer to focus on.
Thank you. And I think I'll add to that and say, if you're taking a computational approach, part of the output of that system is the input of information. So from my perspective, part of the challenge of decision making is also ensuring that the information that people get is accurate and that they can interpret it effectively. And that, of course, is a huge challenge, ensuring that you've calibrated the risk information to people's sincere ability to be able to interpret it.
I view that as kind of balancing the input to the frailty of the computer. Yes. And I always think of your work that way. It's about understanding what people can handle mm-hmm. in a sort of biological and psychological sense, and then figuring out how to give them the information they need in that capacity.
Exactly. And I think that sometimes we have to be a little creative in terms of the types of risk communication that we're willing to present to people. It's not always just we're frustrated that they don't understand probability, but what can we do to transform that information to have people from a wide range of backgrounds interpret it correctly, taking into account their own capacities?
We've been talking a lot about really high stakes decisions like death and getting vaccinated, hopefully everyone's vaccinated, and sort of my perspective, I'm still tracking down a lot of different ways that decision making go wrong. The why is really important, and I'm really excited to talk about it some more. But often, even just our everyday decision making can be suboptimal and inefficient. And to sort of put in layman's terms what everyone else has said on the stage, like, it's hard. There's a lot of different sources of information that we're dealing with, a lot of different factors for everyone to consider, short-term, long-term, things that I want, things that I should have. And we often don't have the time. As Paul said, we're sort of low wattage in our thinking. And so you might be tired, you might be distracted, you might just be busy. And so we have to take these shortcuts in order to do the best we can with what we're working with, even in these low stakes decisions.
And that's a perfect contrast, actually. I think a lot of the classical views today are about mental shortcuts and being overwhelmed by information. And that's certainly true. They describe the COVID-19 pandemic as also an infodemic, meaning there's so much, there's a cascade of sources of information. But I would just challenge that a little bit and say, even if you had the perfect computer that could process everything, is that how you would want to make the best decisions? And my theoretical perspective argues that, no, you really want to get the essence. What does it all amount to in terms of the bottom line? So it's a little bit different than mental shortcuts, but I know there's research on multiple sides of this question.
I just can't help hearing Valerie talk. It's so important, Adrienne and I have talked about this as well, to remember how big the stakes are.
Yeah.
You know, the US federal government did one amazing thing during COVID, which is it spent about $40 billion to develop vaccines at light speed.
Right.
And you know, this is like one of the greatest accomplishments of humankind, probably. And it's really striking that we built these incredible vaccines and then nobody took them.
Right.
And it just points out that you can spend $40 million on the technology, $40 billion on the technology, we didn't spend really very much time at all thinking about the decisions people would make when they were confronted with the vaccines. We should have spent $1 billion on that, and we would have done more for healthcare than probably anything we'll do in the next five decades.
Yeah. Would you want to? So I think we talked a little bit, in our prep about what constitutes a bad decision. And sort of how different disciplines think about that.
I'm happy to start. I think my perspective is slightly different mm-hmm. in the fact that I study how people make decisions mostly with data visualizations and specifically with forecasts of hazards. So we ultimately know what happens after hazard. So we have kind of a metric of what would be a good decision for people. And we can use that to kind of look forward to see how we would like people to respond in the future. So in that way, we can calibrate someone's risk, measure their risk fairly acutely. Mm-hmm. So when I think of a bad decision, I think of someone whose personal beliefs about their risk are very different from their true risk. There's a disconnect there, an error. And I think that isn't how everyone on this panel thinks about it, but it simplifies it in that it's a very specific problem space that we ultimately just need to move people or help them calibrate their risk effectively. So for example, with COVID-19, different people have different risk levels based on their health, their pre-established conditions. So we actually know very clearly, at least in a ranking system, who's at more risk than someone else. But someone might not be aware of their own risk levels, given that they don't appreciate the implications of this particular health condition that they might have, or their job might put them under high risk. So for those individuals who don't have well-calibrated risk, one thing we can do is help them move more towards an accurate understanding of risk. This happens a lot with hurricanes, too. The people who are less likely to evacuate from hurricanes are young men because they have all of this agency. And so they think once they see a hurricane coming, see the flood levels rising, that's when they're going to evacuate. But it's already too late at that point. So we want to help them understand their actual risk.
Interesting. Anyone else want to weigh in on that?
I hesitated to use the word bias, even though I really wanted to.
That's okay. That'll set us all off.
Yeah, I would love to hear kind of what you guys think and if you want to frame it that way.
Hannah, you should say something about that.
I love me a good bias. So, bias is certainly a really loaded word in the judgment decision-making world that I live in, where you have to be very confident that people are making the wrong decision. That something is pushing people in the wrong direction for that to be considered a bias. And so this question of sort of what counts as wrong, I think, sort of falls into two buckets where we have like an objectively wrong answer. So Leith might say, like, if you know that if you get COVID, then you have a very high probability of succumbing to the disease, then choosing not to get vaccinated is then the wrong decision. In the sorts of work that I do, we might say, like, if you make a decision that's inconsistent with your preferences, if you make a decision that's influenced by stuff that it shouldn't be, sort of extraneous information that really has no bearing on your situation, then that's probably the wrong decision. But there's also more subjectively wrong decisions. So for those folks who saw Cass Sunstein talk the other day, he talked about putting calorie counts at movie theaters. And so if you're a health psychologist or you're a public policy person and you want people to make healthier eating choices at the movie theater, you might think putting calorie counts would help people make a better informed decision. They don't go for the jumbo-sized monster popcorn. They consume fewer calories and they're slimmer and you think that you've nailed it. But what Cass was talking about is sort of this neglected welfare effect. That while the health psychologist thinks that they've nailed it, the actual consumer is less happy. They didn't enjoy the movie as much because they didn't have their popcorn, or if they did get the popcorn, then they kind of feel bad consuming it and consuming so much of it. And so maybe they're a little bit slimmer, but for that particular person, it was worth it for them, and so now they're worse off overall. So these more subjective wrong decisions is a really interesting discussion to have. Like, should we be trying to fix those, or should we be keeping ourselves more to these objectively wrong decisions? And I think that's often conflated in this domain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But you do get into this kind of circular paradox. You know, people do self-destructive things that they're happy about in the moment. And then over the long term, they're very unhappy. And of course, there's things like the Iowa gambling test was trying to model that in the mm-hmm. laboratory. I think everybody, that point is extremely well taken, though, to think about, is it really a question of, you know, maximizing the utility of that moment in terms of the objective qualities or not? Mm-hmm. There's some evidence that some of these biases, if you think in this biased way, which is logically incoherent, and violates probability rules,
It's actually associated sometimes with better long-term health outcomes because it avoids a particular public health paradox. I know, it's weird.
I know, it's hard for me to listen to that.
Gist-based intuition, you know, because it involves this public health paradox that if you're perfectly calibrated to some risks and you multiply them out, you're going to engage in the risky behavior, and a sizable minority of people, not everyone, is going to have a really bad outcome. So that produces that dilemma. You calibrate them and then say, well, you know, screening is a lot less effective than I thought it was going to be. I shouldn't screen because now I know the actual probability. By the way, I don't advocate that answer.
Yeah, I mean, I think this goes to, I mean, we're all scientists, but we're also people who influence policy. And it's almost easier to be a scientist who figures out what's going on and how you can predict what people are going to do next than it is to make this paternalistic decision that there's a right answer. Sometimes, as Hannah said, it's easy. There's some class of things where people are logically circular in their choices, or you tell them something completely irrelevant and they flip out and do something crazy. These are easy cases where we can say, this is wrong. You know, this makes no sense. Right. But there are this much larger swath of choices where we have to make a paternalistic decision. And I think that we struggle. In my training as an economist, we're really taught never tell people what to do. You should be libertarian. And Cass Sunstein and Dick Thaler kind of bit off this problem about 10 years ago. They invented this term that none of us really love called libertarian paternalism. This is really meant to be an oxymoron. And they made this argument that nudging makes sense, and sometimes you just have to bite the bullet and say, nobody should use drugs. We're gonna make that decision. And you might like using drugs, but I'm gonna make the decision for you that you can't. And I think libertarian paternalism is kind of falling on hard times right now. People are much more cautious about what Dick and Cass were arguing for, and worry now more that we've kind of been pushing people in ways that really maybe we're not justified in pushing.
Right. So I'm going to switch to a slightly different theme and ask you about what sorts of things would benefit from better understanding or a fuller understanding. We had a little bit of discussion about architecture, choice architecture systems, and so I'm wondering if you could comment on that.
Yeah, everyone's looking at me, so I'm happy to start. So I think sort of what Paul was touching on, how nudging and choice architecture, mm-hmm. which is sort of the implementation of those nudges, is falling on hard times. I think part of that is a lack of understanding of when nudges are going to be successful, in what domains and in what types of implementations, and when they're not going to work or when they'll even backfire. And so I think a better understanding, a richer understanding of the heterogeneity across all of these different types of domains and implementations to better predict when this is going to work would be really beneficial. A meta-analysis came out like a couple months ago in Nature Human Behavior, I think, that found essentially massive heterogeneity across all these different domains, nudges in food versus environmental decisions versus financial decisions, social decisions, nudges that based on default effects, based on providing more information, and really found just a mess that some things work great, some things don't, and really not being able to come away with a clean understanding of when things work and why they might work. So I really hope to see more action in that space.
But it's like asking, almost, and I'm going to caricature this a little unfairly, it's like asking if medicines work, you know, to ask if nudges work. Well, it depends on the medicine, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And it depends on what it's for. So I think the same logic applies here. And I you know, let me give a plug for your website. On Dr. Perfecto's website, there's a wonderful argument in favor of small experiments, small in quotes. Now, remember, we have sampling theory, so we can infer from samples to populations. But the notion of why people are, you know, why does the nudge work or doesn't work? What are the mechanisms behind it? We're really right now in a situation of you know, an absence of information about why. And that's what we're all trying to address here. And I just love the argument you made, which I thought was very effective.
Yeah.
For
small experiments.
Yeah, I think the fact that you point out, hey, it's kind of like why do medicine, when will medicine work, when will medicine not work? I mean, the fact that we're asking this question, like how well do nudges work, sort of reflects our lack of appreciation of all the variety, heterogeneity in that space.
But I mean, just to be the anti-nihilist for a second, I mean, the truth is we know, all of us know, that nudges can be insanely effective. And while it's sometimes hard to predict what nudge will work and what nudge won't, and while individual experiments, I mean, I'll give an example, which is slightly controversial, but probably super famous, and only Hannah will kill me for doing it. Eric Johnson and Elke Weber have done a bunch of really beautiful experiments looking at organ donation. I should have said analyses, looking at organ donation. And the general story seems to be that in countries like the United States, where you have to actively become an organ donor, something like 15 or 20% are willing to be organ donors. And in matched countries in Europe, where the default is the other way, so this is a nudge because the rule is you can decide to be an organ donor or not. In the US, you have to actively decide. The default is you won't be an organ donor. In countries like Sweden, you have to actively decide not to be an organ donor. And in those countries, organ donation rates are more like 80, 85%. And the result is that there's not an organ shortage and people don't die from lack of organs. So this is an example of a choice architecture, a really simple change to the way you build the choices into our culture that can have a profound impact, like eliminating the need for new technologies to achieve organ donation. And so I just want to remind I'm really saying this to the audience because you guys know this better than me, that these choice architectures are incredibly powerful. And while we don't always know why they'll work, we do kind of know what the tools are. And people like Hannah kind of look at these tools and try and think about ways to predict what's going to work in a different setting, or we can do an experiment. But these really can change the way societies work.
Yeah, I'd like to echo that. In appreciating the power of developing choice architecture systems, I think it would be useful to consider this one of the most effective tools. And if we're considering where to apply these tools, I think that one of the goals of science should be to look at the biggest problems facing our planet and use some of the power of decision making in this room to literally solve the problems. That might sound blue sky, but I think that this type of research has the power to do that if we direct our energy towards solving those problems.
I can't help it. Valerie, you just talked about this. So, you know, the climate bill was originally a climate bill that was going to help the world in the next generation. And as Valerie points out, people struggle with valuing the future. It's just not something built into our brains very well. Now the climate bill has a new name. Mm-hmm. It's the Beat Inflation Bill. And it's going to pass, right, apparently, because I can really focus on the fact that I need to fix inflation right now.
Right.
And I think that's a really interesting piece of decision architecture, switching from fix the future to fix the present, and then the bill passes.
Right. Very true. I want to ask about your thoughts about the ways in which the field is shifting. Think about interdisciplinary approaches, sort of your thoughts about what you've seen change and changing in the future, about the way that the field is doing its work.
Everyone's looking at me. I'm very interdisciplinary in nature, and I think that was kind of the angle of the question. And I think what we're seeing is that people are appreciating the capacity of decision-making research to really influence many different sectors. And so a variety of individuals are working interdisciplinary for those solutions. So I work with data visualization scientists, domain application experts, and psychologists and economists as well to try to address some of these large problems. So I think taking a problem framing allows lots of people from different applications to become invested in solving that problem.
Any other thoughts?
Well, I think one of the key trends in the future, of course, is going to be artificial intelligence and the comparison of human intelligence and artificial intelligence. And some people in our fields have, already said, well, this is going to be an improvement because artificial intelligence, machine learning can aggregate large amounts of information. And the machines will process this information without biases, to use that loaded term. And Danny Kahneman's made this argument, as you know. And he's a Nobel Prize winner, so I probably shouldn't disagree with him. But I'm going to. Because I think there certainly are really important problems that artificial intelligence will be helpful to. And I'm doing research on machine learning. But there are also very important divergences between what the machine would decide and what a human would decide. And I think sometimes the human being is right. And I think they get that, you know, the machine will be very literal and be in the details. And I think people, on the other hand, can be more gist-based. And I think there will be times when those diverge and the humans will be right and the machines will not be right. And I hope we're not going to be in a situation where we don't get a vote.
I would add to that, Valerie, that I also worry so much about the objective function for the machines. When we have a machine learning problem, we have to teach the machine kind of what the right answer is or what the goal is or what the endpoint should be. And this runs the risk of a tremendous amount of paternalism, sometimes in the hands of people who don't realize they're making those decisions for all of us. There have been so many famous failures in machine learning where some implicitly racist bias got into the algorithm and then it showed up in what the machine decided. And so, I mean, I really think the idea that the machines are going to be great at harvesting information for us to use, that's kind of exciting and nerve-wracking. But the idea that we're going to hand the objective function for our society over to these machines and let them decide, I mean, I was worried about handing it over to Dick Thaler and Cass Sunstein.
I would like to say, though, if taking a slightly different framing of assuming a long-term future that machines will have so much more access to information that we don't have ourselves, and assuming that they do have access to the types of information that we would use in our own decision-making process, those are lots of assumptions, then in theory, they could help support us. It's the same kind of argument with automated driving, automated cars. You know, if you can get all the automated systems working together and they can integrate, that would be great. But that is that's much further in the future than a few people having automated cars and the ethics of that.
The cars are easy, it seems to me, Lace, because you want them to get you from A to B and not kill anyone.
Yeah.
I'm just worried about the machine deciding that I shouldn't be eating popcorn at the movies because I'd be better off slimmer. And I'd rather eat popcorn at the movies.
I guess I'm imagining a future where a machine can take those types of decision criteria that you have and weigh them in the same way that you would and help you come to a conclusion that you might want to as well. And I'm not saying that can happen anytime soon, but I think there will be a future in our lifetimes where machine learning has that capacity.
So I really like the idea of a machine, you building a machine that tells me this is what you're going to look like tomorrow. Now, I mean, seriously, right? I mean, how do you visualize, how do we take all that information and visualize it back to me in a way that utilizes my limited signal-to-noise ratios and my limited ability to represent things and really tells me what's it going to look like? Who are you going to be? Do you want to be that person? I just don't, I'm really nervous about handing over the choice, because the choice implies an objective function, and I just don't know who gets to make the decision about what that objective function is for me.
And I think that raises another good point, which is that, say, the machine would come to the exact same choice as you would, maybe you'll like it less because the machine came to it. You know, I mean, I think there's a lot of trust that goes into this, and I think more research on this topic would be very useful. But I think having our decisions be supported by machines could potentially be useful.
Yeah, I think that's super exciting and clearly on the horizon.
Right. Any thoughts from...
Everyone's looking at me. Well, I will say there's a lot of work in judgment and decision making on this issue of if the machine is deciding for me, then how do I feel about it? And what domains is it okay for me to get help from an algorithm versus not okay for me to get help from an algorithm? If I see the algorithm mess up and make a bad decision or a decision I'm unhappy with, now how do I feel about this algorithm in this domain versus an algorithm in another domain? So you're right on the money that that's a really hot area that people see coming and are trying to get out in front of with the empirics to try to improve when that actually comes to be.
Well, which is already there. I mean, if you go on an online dating app, a machine is deciding who you should be thinking about dating. That's a great example where people are ceding control to an app for filtering a large amount of data. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe that's good, but I don't know.
And I think sometimes, you know, we might become uncomfortable with the types of decisions that machines make, even if we know that that could be the decision that we wanted. An example is I work with the Red Cross, and they are interested in creating forecast-based financing systems, wherein which if there's a certain forecast, a particular amount of aid would be automatically issued, or maybe evacuation orders would be automatically issued. And they have to work with the people on the ground to decide what is that threshold. And they want them to make it in advance when they have time to reflect and it's not in the moment.
That's so smart.
And then when it happens, there's this conflict because they are aware that they've made this threshold, but and all of a sudden, their emotions get involved. And after the fact, they're happy that the machine made the choice at that time. But in the moment, they are, I don't know how to describe the uncomfortableness of going with the decision that actually they made in advance, but that the machine triggered for them.
That's such a good example.
Yeah. I am wondering if there's anything happening on Slido.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Slido, can you, oh, there we go.
Awesome.
So our first question is, given that we are all getting our information through the internet these days, is that increased use of the internet for information flow increasing herd mentality by employing the use of algorithms that steer people toward false facts?
I heard a sigh, Paul.
Yeah, no, I mean, don't we all sigh over that? There's a critical problem. Well, my perspective on it as a, I don't know what I am, biological psychologist, economist, is, you know, our critical challenge is that we really have very little bandwidth for information. I think that that's kind of the bottom line. And you hear that from all of us. People don't have the ability to represent too big a data set too accurately. And the internet is that, right? It's the biggest data set that anyone's ever assembled. And clearly, we've handed over to a group of companies the right to decide how to filter that information down into the narrow slice that we're capable of managing. And those companies are clearly driven by a set of objective functions that have to do with maximizing their bottom line. That is clearly not what we should be doing. I mean, given if I told you there's too much information for you to digest and we have to abstract it in some useful way to let you optimize, the idea that you would choose an algorithm that maximized the profits of a large corporation in order to guide you seems completely headed in the wrong direction. So I don't know what the answer is to, I don't know, Hannah actually thinks about this more probably than I do, but I mean, this is clearly the wrong direction for decision science.
It's really interesting that you point to me, because I think we sort of teased it a little bit earlier, or I thought maybe, Paul, you were going in this direction of that we are sort of the scientists removed or studying what happens, and then we pass it on to policymakers and other interventionists to then make something of that out in the real world. So, I mean, I certainly agree. I generally was just sort of nodding along with your general concern, and Adrienne noted that we all kind of sighed at that question. So to me, it sort of sounded like the question asker also seems to have an opinion in terms of that, yeah, we are receiving information, like confirmation bias, like that's a very real phenomenon. And so if I have a belief about a particular topic and I'm being given, and the algorithm knows that, and so the algorithm gives me information that confirms that belief, so I engage with that even more, so I like that more, and that's a sort of a positive feedback loop there, which really isn't isn't doing anyone very many favors in terms of getting a full picture of what's going on.
Right. Yeah, and the more it whips people up, the more they click, the more it whips people up. So this does obviously have a great side, a democratization side to it. Every voice is heard. On the other hand, these voices are amplified in ways that are toxic sometimes. I would just point to some research by some colleagues of mine, David Broniatowski and Chris Wolf, on the effects of, in domains such as vaccination and so on, of misinformation. There are, I won't go into any more detail, but it's obviously a crucially important social cognitive health factor.
Yeah. Another one?
Yes.
Okay.
Why do people make decisions that are against their self-interest?
Do they?
Oh, yes.
Do they think that they're doing that? I think that's the question. When we talk about like that subjective type of bad decision, they probably think that they're making the right decision, whether it's maybe the wrong decision in the short term, right in the long term, or vice versa. They probably think they're generally doing the right thing, otherwise they wouldn't do it. But it's more whether it's somebody else, the decision maker or the algorithm, who marks that as the decision against their self-interest.
That's certainly something that, you know, and I think you expressed it so well, that subjective happiness with your own decision versus the objective, what the objective might say. Absolutely true. But I think there's also another thing that happens with people where they regret later, where once they know how it turned out and how bad it really was, and they've lived life some, they say to themselves, I mean, people will say, oh, I would do it again, but not really. Right, they really wouldn't do it again if they had the insight that they had. And I think of that probably from a developmental perspective a little bit, because you know, you think of the teenager and you know, remember when you knew everything? And even when teenagers are very well informed and very logical, they haven't had the experience. So sometimes they will look back on decisions that they wish they could take back.
I mean, I don't actually disagree. And Valerie and I both worked on teenagers. I actually got interested in that because of Valerie and asked some of those questions myself. I would discriminate between when someone tells you they made the wrong decision and then they make it again the same way. Yeah. We hear that a lot. And the scientist in me is kind of like, why did you do that 8 times and each time tell me it was the wrong decision? Maybe you're being really consistent here and what you're saying isn't what you're doing. So that's kind of an interesting question. Why do people say different things than they do? And then there's this second question, which Valerie raises, which is what happens when someone makes a really bad decision and then, given the opportunity, makes a different decision the next time? I think those are distinct. And so when I playfully said, do people really make the wrong decision? What I was really, I guess, trying to do is separate those two classes. I made a bad decision and I'll get it right next time. I really learned something. Mm-hmm. And if you had presented to me better, I would have gotten it right that time. And this kind of, for me, more interesting situation where people consistently do one thing and say they want to do something else, whether that's because they're very present focused when they make the decision and very future focused when they're thinking about it. There's lots of reasons why that might be, but that's for me as a psychologist, those are kind of the really weird, interesting ones.
I absolutely agree with all of those things, and I really appreciate the framing that this panel has taken. And I would say, just to think about, you know, people sincerely making wrong decisions, if you think about one of the hardest choices that people make, some life or death choice, I study hurricane forecasting, for example. When it comes down to it, if someone believes that they will die, they will try to evacuate. When they sincerely believe that they are at harm of death, if they can. There's these other factors that make it so that they don't have the resources or the ability to evacuate. But if someone actually believes that they are at risk, people evacuate. Now, getting someone to have that accurate belief about if they sincerely are at risk or not, there's so much involved in that type of presenting information to people that can be really tricky. But if you look at the most base, simple decision of, you know, do I need to save myself or not, people tend to make self-serving, which would be a good decision to, of course, not die. And I think that if we use that as a baseline, I think all of the other more subtle decisions, especially that we were talking about, those are more ambiguous, what right or wrong is. But I think appreciating that in some cases people will make the right decision is also a good thing as well.
Thank you, Liz. Yet another one, Derek? Okay. Mm-hmm.
Following up on that, are there certain types of decisions that people make really well, and are there insights that we can draw from those decision-making processes that can be used to help people make more challenging decisions better?
Great question.
Yeah.
That's a great
question.
It's a great question. We all agree on that.
Yeah.
Good job, audience.
Well, so there's some properties of decisions that people are better at making. If you make the decision more frequently and you get more frequent feedback, you tend to be better at being able to adjust to those decisions so that you yourself are more happy with them. Decisions that have the result that are more closer in time are more useful than faraway decisions. Those are much, much harder to make. Do you have other insights?
I would have said, I really like that you flipped it to what are people bad at, which I think is kind of the same question. Like, the thing people are really terrible at is valuing future states. The farther away something is in time, the harder it is to get the decision right. People are really present biased and present focused, and that's why people don't save enough for retirement. It's why people can't seem to figure out how important it is to protect the environment. And if we can find ways to bring those decisions into the present for them, they can often do much better. Mm-hmm. The one other thing I would add is people struggle when there's too much data. And the thing that we can do to help people is sort of boil down the data into a simpler form, into the minimum necessary informational set. It also can really help to center the data where they expect to see it. If the data is kind of off expectation, they tend to ignore it. This is why people get stuck in the rabbit holes that Valerie was talking about. People say things like, well, I'll take the vaccine when more people have tried it. It's like 3.5 billion people have had the vaccine. It's like enough people have tried it already. So I think this idea of bringing it to the present, boil it down to the minimum informational set that you can possibly manage with, and try and park that information where people expect to see it. Mm-hmm. Those are, I think, good general rules.
How do you bring it to the present?
Yeah, that's really hard. We know the example I gave earlier today was we're going to fix inflation instead of the planet. The inflation's bugging me right now, and I live in New York, so I don't ever buy gas. But if I didn't live in New York, I'd buy gas, and that would bug me. And the fact that burning fossil fuels will melt all the glaciers and New York City will be under 40 feet of water. Oh, whatever, that's right. A long time from now.
I think another way of framing bringing things to the present is also making them less abstract. So the more you can make the information concrete, like your energy bill will go down this amount of dollars, not we project in the future, there's this probability, et cetera. I think that that's really useful because I think people translating their physical reality to some abstract future is where people can kind of go awry. Mm. So if you can, I think that goes to your centering it where they expect, but also on themselves in a concrete way. There's ways for data visualization to do that, which is always my plug.
one way that stands out for me, like one of my favorite problems is I ask you, I mean, we've done these experiments a million times, Valerie's in some of these experiments. I put 12 candies in front of you. And I know what your favorite candy is because I was very carefully asking you questions about that before. And you pick a candy and I say, hey, that's not your favorite candy. You say, oh my God, there were 12 things. It was so hard to figure out what was going on. And we know that as choice sets grow, that's really problematic. In fact, people are better making choices if you say, instead of saying pick your favorite candy, you say, why don't you tell me what your least favorite candies are? And we'll take those off the table first. And we sort of winnow the set down to your sort of three best candidates. And then you always get the right candy. So I think this idea of you know, winnowing the information can be very practical. Mm-hmm. We just have to figure out what you don't need to see and how to take it off the table before you make your choice amongst the limited set that you can. And making it really concrete like this, where it's, you know, here are the three things you have to choose. It's really simple. That's where people really excel in my mind.
You know what would be good at that? Machine learning. Computers could help us with that.
Machine learning does have its use. I'm thinking, though, of that wonderful
it's
picture.
It's going to know which candies I don't like.
I'm thinking of that picture of yours, you know, with the uncertainty growing as the hurricane spreads. You've got these wonderful visualizations. And there was one point at which you said you had to take lines out to make it less complicated. And it's less accurate in a way, but it's more accessible. Is that an example of this? Or?
Yeah, so there's these hurricane forecast visualizations. And traditionally, they're shown by the National Hurricane Center with this cone like this. And people widely misunderstand them. They think the storm is growing in size over time. So instead, we made visualizations that show different paths, but show the distribution of paths. And what happens is if you show people too many paths, they start to think that there's just so much uncertainty, the storm could go anywhere. But if you recreate the visualization and sample in a very careful way and show the full distribution but with fewer paths, then it gives people a sense of the uncertainty and just the information they need. And then people can make a more effective decision.
Yeah. So you know what? We have 5 minutes left. This time went very quickly. I want to close by asking you each to say a word about, say, 5 years from now, what do you want to see? What would you like to have happen? Like, you know, what major accomplishments would you like to see for the field? And since I'm looking this way.
Everyone's looking at me again.
Yes.
Having to start again. I think in the next 5 years, I think it's not unreasonable to hope for, to even expect some more resolution on this issue of heterogeneity that I mentioned earlier on. Sort of, we run our studies with our convenience samples, at least I know we have folks doing lots of cool stuff in other domains. I run my study with my convenience samples and don't pay too much attention to how the sample I'm using or the context I'm studying or the how I'm operationalizing the topics I'm interested in, how those things might then affect the likelihood of that finding generalizing to something really important, a higher stakes policy implementation, for example. And that's what we're seeing with the nudges, not being able to have a good sense of like which type of nudge is going to work where. And so now, really just in the last couple years, we're appreciating how severe this issue can be. And so now that we know the problem, I think within 5 years, I'd be really excited to see us have a much better grip on that problem and solve it.
Thank you. I hope that we continue to reject dogma and be less dogmatic about methods and recognize that diverse voices will have diverse opinions, and that's a good thing. I think the small experiment, the large data set, the interdisciplinarity, I hope all that continues. And the evidence-based nature, that's really what matters, the quality of the work and that it's evidence-based. And I think APA has been a leader. I think especially recently with some of the work on COVID-19 and in other domains, it's been a real leader. I hope that the evidence base continues to be, you know, our guiding star, our North Star. That's what we have to pay attention to.
Thank you, Valerie. Paul.
So I'm going to say a policy thing. Okay. I mean, I have all these scientific
that's okay too.
But I would just like to see people who are making decisions about how we're building our culture going forward, taking into account the psychology of judgment and decision-making. We have been whining about this as psychologists for a couple of decades now, and we've made surprisingly little traction at getting people to worry about how to present climate information, to worry about how to present vaccination information. We see governments spending tons of money, but not on the psychology. And I'm not pitching research here. I'm not saying I need more money for my research. We need to be attentive to the fact that decision makers are human beings motivated by psychology that we basically understand at this point. We're fetching about the edges to some degree. Right. And I just hope that what we understand can begin to influence more what we actually do as a culture.
Right. Thank you, Paul. Yeah, Lise.
In line with that, I would like to encourage more researchers to take on large global problems, to do it from both a policy and from a research perspective. I think that there's so much capacity for this type of research to make real important change. And I think that it might be one of the research branches that can make the changes that are needed for humans to take different actions on the planet. So I'd like to see more people really engaging in more applied forms of this work.
Thank you. Thank you all, and thank you for joining. It's been a great discussion, and I've enjoyed and have been honored to facilitate the discussion. So thank you. Thank you for coming, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks.